That's pretty good. You excited to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Why don't you stand with me? Talks amongst yourselves. All right, this morning we're going to sing about God's forgiveness. That's good news, right? God's forgiveness is good news, right? All right. Who needed some forgiveness this morning? All right. We're all open that we had a little temper this morning or something, right? It says in the song that His forgiveness is like sweet honey on our lips. Okay. Don't worry about it. And so, I don't know where my mom went.
I'm here.
There we go. Here we go. All right, let's sing about God's forgiveness and act like none of that happened.
It's 2 weeks in a row we said something,
listen to what this says. I don't want to abuse your grace.
On the skin. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing.
Thank you. take the blame because I used the mic and didn't put batteries in it. So I'm sorry. Did y'all see that? See that, how I apologize so quick? Isn't that very nice? So later I expect like some beef stroganoff. All right, well, we better keep going. Hey, we want to say hello to everybody, but here's the thing. We're going to be talking about money today. Everybody say money. Money. So this is your chance to escape. All right, if you want to run out of here. But remember, if you run out of here, you're going to have to ignore a lot of scripture because Jesus talked a lot about money. So we're going to talk about money. But here's the thing. When you say hello to one another today, the question is, if you suddenly got a lot of money, would you spend it? Would you save it? Or would you give it away? All right, that's your choice. Spend it, save it, give it away. Be honest. Be honest, or I'll do a sermon online, okay? All right, so let's go around and say hello to everybody this morning. Guys can have a seat this morning. Doing things a little bit different today, and I want to encourage you for just a minute to pull out your phone and open the Church Center app. If you don't have that, you can use the QR code in front of you and download it real quick. But if you'll pull out your phone and go to the app, and then on the home page it looks kind of like this. I've got my text really big because I'm blind, but yours will look something like this. And you'll see up there at the top, it says, add your oikos. So just a refresher, we've been talking a lot about oikos. We want to create a culture of discipleship. I believe that every Christian should be discipling somebody to help them get to wherever you are. You can't lead somebody beyond where you're at in Christ, but you can lead them to where you are. Then get them connected with somebody else to help both of you go further. And the oikos in the Bible gets translated into household. And remember, in a biblical household, you had several generations of the same family. Also, the law was that if a stranger showed up at your house, you had to invite them in and let them stay and show hospitality so you'd have strangers in your house. Also, in Jewish culture, if you got in financial trouble, then you could sell yourself into slavery for a period of 7 years. But whoever purchased you had to also treat you like their own child. So they'd have to bring you in and give you room and food and everything. And so an oikos was this amalgam of all kinds of people. They were all under the same roof that they talked with every day and had influence. So your oikos is your influence, your circle of influence, the people you come in contact every day. The Bible says that in the early church, the disciples just went about their day, going to work, going to the temple, going to get water, and whoever they met, whoever God put in their path, they would share the gospel with them, they would pray with them, and the Bible says many were saved. Amen? So what we're trying to do is do church the way church was intended to be. So that we are trying to reach people on a personal level, that every single one of us takes seriously the command to go and make disciples. and that is your oikos. And we're trying to follow the example of Christ, saying, Lord, give us 12 people. And there, we believe there's 12, at least 12, that God is calling you to. Not just to share a prayer every now and then, but to intentionally create a relationship so that you can disciple them. And it may start just by building a friendship, offering to pray for them, inviting them to church, just being available when they're in a time of need. And so we are encouraging you to do that. What I want to do is create a master list, if you will, so that I can pray and that we can all pray. And so if you'll click on that where it says add your oikos, you're going to add names. We don't want last names. I don't need phone numbers, emails. We're not contacting anybody. This is just so that I can be praying. And I'm asking the Lord that throughout all of our campuses that we would have 1,000 people that we're trying to disciple that are not in the church right now. And some of those will never come to church. That's not the point. The point is that we're doing what God has called us to do. Amen. And so as you submit that, they'll come to me and I'll be able to put together a list and just continue to look for ways for God to open the door and disciple them. So we're going to take just for a minute and I'm going to fill mine out. And I'm going to give you a chance to fill yours out and then we'll continue. Right now, just put whoever God is calling you to and be intentional. And the Bible says that it will help us grow spiritually as well as we minister to other people. Amen. Pastor Lance, if he'll bring his prayer team up this morning. If you will, let's all stand if you need a little more time, take the time you need, but let's all stand. Before we really begin worship, I want to have a time of prayer. The scripture says that his house is a house of prayer. Amen. And so if there is anything that you need prayer for, you would like somebody to anoint you, we want you to come forward. The altars are open if you want to come and kneel and pray. And for just a moment, we're going to give the Lord this time as we pray. So anything you need, just come and bring it to the Lord. If you would like somebody to pray with you, then come up here to one of our pastors.
the heart to our condemn. All feel unworthy. All who hurt with nothing left. When all that you are holy, in no way.
Sing out hallelujah.
If you raise the other side, or how far a chase river from lonely seas to where they rise against the rush of grace descending from the source of its supply. 'Cause in the highlands and the heartache, you need the more or less incline. I would search and stop at nothing. You're just not that hard to find. Oh, so I'll praise you on the mountain, and I'll praise you in the mountains in my way. Lord, the sun will wear my feet off. So I'll praise you in the valleys on the sand. No less God within the shadows. No less faithful in the night.
We're about to go into communion, and I just want to bring your eyes to this song, and it's saying, no matter where you are, it starts with this perspective of, God, if you were on the mountain, I would climb the mountain just to be with you. And then it changes perspectives to realize that, oh, how far beneath your glory does your kindness extend the path? We can't fall far enough, and our God is chasing, and he wants this full communion. As we are going to take part in that this morning, I just want to give you time to start getting your mind right. As we sing this last part, it says, from the gravest of all valleys come the pastures we call grace. If you could paint the picture, the man they've been following for 3 years, their Savior, is hanging on a cross, and to their knowledge, it's all ending. And he dies. The ground shakes. Lightning cracks. There's screams, cattle running everywhere. Death are coming back to life. A curtain tears. And in the scariest moment of their lives, it says, from the gravest of all valleys come the pastures we call grace. God takes everything the enemy ever intended to turn for evil for the good of those that love him. And I don't know where you're sitting. I don't know where you're going. Maybe you feel low this morning. But the song says, there's no less God within the shadows, no less faithful when the night leads me astray. You're the heaven where my heart is, in the highlands and the heartache, all the same. This morning, just take this time to sit in the presence of God and still your spirit. Lay everything at his feet and get ready to hear the whisper of God. Let's sing this morning.
From the gravest of all valleys come the pastures we call on grace. A mighty river flowing upward from a deep but empty grave. Praise you in the mountains.
I think we ought to just give the Lord a praise offering this morning. Amen. I'm going to ask you to be seated. If Pastor Lance and our ushers can come forward. We're going to begin to pass out the elements this morning. And as you receive them, if you want to pray, if you want to stand up and worship, whatever you want to do after you receive the elements. But if you have never accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, this is the time to do it. Just with a simple prayer of faith. Saying, Lord, I know that I have sinned. I know that you died for me, and I receive you as my Lord and Savior. The Bible says that if you confess with your mouth, if you believe with your heart, that you will be saved. And if you make that confession today, then you are a child of God. Amen. We sing that song, and we hit that one phrase that says that the Lord walks me through my failures just to get me to the other side. And I remember all my failures. It's not easy to learn how to sing through the shadows. But what has allowed me to get to a place where I can rejoice even in what feels and seems like a bad moment is remembering how God has brought me through time and time again. And I think it's important that we always go back and we remember where we were. We remember our failures. We remember our sin. And we remember that Christ died. Not only that we might be forgiven, but it says he was bruised for my iniquity. The word iniquity means stain. It means somebody has done something to me and left a stain on my soul. And so his healing goes deep even to what others have done. It says, by the stripes upon his back we are healed. And it's a reminder that he is able to heal, to restore, to make new all things. But aren't you glad we have a God who walks us through our failures and brings us to the other side? Amen. Amen. As you receive your elements, if you, again, just want to meditate upon the Lord, if you want to stand and worship, in just a minute, we'll take them together as a church family.
Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest trial and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when striving to see my comforter, my all in all. Here in the love of Christ, I'll stand. The ground, his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, and bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands in victory, since Christ has lost his grief on me.
guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me, from life's first cry to final breath. Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever blow me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here is the power of Christ on stage. Oh, 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 on stage. Oh, 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 oh. I find my strength, I find my hope, I find my help in Christ alone. When fear assails, when darkness falls, I find my peace in Christ alone. I give my life, I give my all, I sing this song to Christ alone.
Is so good. And I'll invite you to be seated for just a moment. I'm reading a book right now, and it's all about the Eucharist and taking communion. One of the things that's really stuck out in my mind is Christ took the bread and he broke it and he gave thanks. And it's a reminder to give thanks for the broken things, because it's in the brokenness that we draw near to God. And if we stay near him in the brokenness, then we will rise with him in the power of the resurrection. Amen. And so if my brokenness is used to draw me close to God, then what can the devil do now? Amen. And so as we remember that he was broken for us, that he would understand, that he would be the compassionate high priest. He's not a God who just says, you know, deal with it. He's a God who draws near to the brokenhearted, and he helps us. And so we are grateful. And so let's eat together, remembering him. Everything in Scripture flows in logic and understanding. His flesh was beaten, and then he bled. His body was broken. And we take the bread first and remember that his body was broken, but the effect of that was his blood flowed. And in the Scripture it says that the life of a creature is found in his blood. So in order for him to pour out his life into us, he had to die. In order for him to pour his life into us, he had to die. And so we remember what he did, understanding that everything he did was just to draw near to us. If you have ever felt that God didn't love you, if you've ever felt unworthy of his love because of things that you've done in the past, your failures, your mistakes, your sin. Remember the cross. The cross says, I love you anyway, and I'll do whatever it takes to get to you. And his blood is poured out for us that we might have the Holy Spirit of God, that we might have power to overcome and live in the resurrection. Amen. Let's drink together in remembrance of him. And I'm going to ask Pastor Vanessa if you'll come and just pray for us.
Let's pray, church. Father, thank you so much for your goodness, your forgiveness, your mercy and grace, Lord. At times we feel like we don't deserve it. But you are constantly seeking us out. Lord, you just want us to draw near to you. If we feel like we are in a place of darkness, depression, anxiety, you are there. In the mountains and the valleys. Father, we love you so much. I pray for Pastor Lee as he gives the message, and that every single person here hears it with an open mind, open heart. Because ultimately it's for you to glorify you. In your holy name we pray, everyone said, amen.
Amen. Let's give the Lord a praise offering. Amen. That was good. Well, I want to get right into the scripture this morning. If you'll turn with me to Matthew chapter 6. Matthew 6, verse 19. We're going to talk about money. Everybody say money. Turn to the person next to you and say, don't run out. You'll be okay. You'll make it. You'll survive. God will help you. Now, as we dig into this scripture, I want to remind you where this comes from. This is toward the end of the Sermon on the Mount, which is the very first message that Christ preaches in public. So let's read this together, starting in verse 19. It says, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy, and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one or love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Amen? Now, the Sermon on the Mount is the very first message. So the very first time that Christ is going to speak to us publicly, his words are, blessed. Everybody say blessed. Now the word blessed means to be blessed. It means to be happy. It means to enjoy life. It means to have peace. Another word is shalom, that you have peace because you're prospering in every area of your life. And so as he begins this, everything, if you can imagine, that is his thesis statement. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Everybody say kingdom. Now, a kingdom is a way. If you live in Texas, then you understand you live in the greatest country in the world. Amen. I'm not sure what that means, that that got the biggest applause of the day. But anyway, it's true. And so wherever you're at, there is a culture, there is an ethos, there is a way of living, there is a way that people interact, there's a way of doing things. And so he's saying this whole message is about how to live and have and own and participate in the kingdom of heaven. Now, the kingdom of heaven is all the things that you will have in heaven, joy, peace, love, no regret, no fear, no anxiety, no stress, Bluebell all the time, no creamy creations. I know I hurt somebody on that one. I know I did. So what he's teaching is you're going to live in this world, but you're not of this world. And so I want you to learn how to live in this world in a way that you have joy, in a way that you have peace, in a way that you have love, in the way that you have this abundance within you. And so the entire message is teaching us, how do I live in a wicked world? How do I live in a place where it is so full of temptation, so full of wickedness, so full of evil, where there is murder, there is rape, there is molestation? How do I live in a place where there is thievery, where there is false teachers, where there are people that are money hungry? How do I live in a world where sex is everywhere all the time, tempting and pushing people away? How do you live in this world and yet still maintain the kingdom of heaven? And he begins to go through a litany of things in order to teach us, how do you work and operate within this subject in order to still maintain the kingdom? And he begins with religion. Now, how many of you know that you can participate in religion in a way that moves you away from God? Amen? You can get so religious that you ain't no good, because all you're doing is judging and condemning everybody else. You're not getting any closer to God. And so he talks about religion. How do you operate within a religious mindset in a way that you're not tempted by the temptations that come with religion? He goes on. He talks about people. How many of y'all would say people are difficult? I expected a bigger applause than Texas right there. Right? People betray you. People hurt you, they cheat on you, they walk out on you, they lie to you, they do all kinds of stuff, and Christ is teaching, how do you live with these people and still maintain your joy? People tell me all the time, well, they made me mad. Well, they might do something that would stir anger in you, but whether you stay mad is up to you. Because joy comes from heaven, and nobody can steal your joy. You can give it up, you can forfeit, you can lay it out, but nobody can take it from you. Amen? And so he goes through that. He talks about sex and marriage. How many of y'all have been married would say, you know, it's tough sometimes? The first sermon is like, amen, but no. Marriage is hard. God says, I'm going to give you somebody that you love, that you're attracted to. They're wonderful, beautiful, incredible, but they're going to drive you nuts. So get ready. Sex is so, they use sex to sell candy, to sell business, to sell everything and anything all over the place. You watch commercials, TV, magazines, they're using sex for everything. And so in a world where we're trying to maintain the sanctity of marriage, temptations to go outside of the marriage, it's constantly happening everywhere all the time. How do you live in this world and maintain the kingdom? He goes on, he talks about business and dealing with business and people having to work with them when people want your job and they don't think you should have got a promotion and office gossip and he begins to deal with how you deal with pain and with hurt and all the things that go with that. He deals with false teachers. There are people everywhere saying that they are Christian, that they know this, they know that, they have this credential, that credential, but what they are teaching is not biblical. And they are causing people to be moved away from Christ instead of moving to Christ, even though they use the name of Christ. And so he's teaching all this, and he's going through this list of things, saying, this is how you operate in this and maintain your kingdom, the kingdom of heaven, in your heart, in your mind. And then he finishes up by talking about money and worry. Isn't that interesting? He puts those two together. Money and worry. Does anybody ever worry about money? Just do this and be honest, right? We all do. It is engulfing the financial pressure and financial stress that we feel every day, paying the bills, making sure everything is done, not to mention the things that we would like to have. And so he is talking about money and worry. And so I want to suggest to you today that the way we handle our money forms our spirit either toward Christ or away from him. The way you handle your money, the way you spend it, the way you save it, the way you give it away, it will either form your spirit to Christ or away, in the same way that religion can either draw you nearer to God or push you further away. And so let's kind of break this down in Matthew 6 there, verse 19. Read this again. He says, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth. Everybody say earth. Where moth and vermin destroy, where thieves break in, but store up yourselves treasures in heaven. Everybody say heaven. So what he's doing, he's giving us a comparison of two different economic systems. You have the earthly economic system and the heavenly economic system. Now, the earthly economic system is based on moths and vermin, right? Y'all know what vermin is. Vermin are rats. Rats, how many of y'all enjoy rats? I remember we had a rat in our house in Florida. We would wake up, and up on the countertop, it had eaten through the plastic of the bread. It had eaten the bread. There were crumbs everywhere. I was angry. Who dares take my bread? And so we figured out where it came in from. So we stuck a towel up in this hole where we figured out the rat came from. And so I don't know what I was thinking. So the next morning, I wake up, and the rat hadn't eaten the bread. The rat's still in my kitchen because I plugged up its door, and it couldn't get out. And I was walking from the living room to the kitchen, and I was barefoot, and something ran over my foot, and I saw this big old rat. I was angry. I was mad. I moved the stove. I told Amy, I said, get a frying pan. We're going to beat this rat down. The rat was as big as my son. He was huge, had more hair. And so he's under the stove now. I'm going to move the stove, and I'm thinking Amy's going to get him with the frying pan. I got a broom. We move the stove, and it runs to the door. Can't get out his door because I got a towel stuffed in there. Turns and runs into the living room at Zachary, who's about 2 years old, who starts going, ah! I was angry. He goes off, and he runs, and I'm chasing him with a broom. Amy's chasing him with a frying pan. He goes into a bedroom where Zach's toys are. There's like 7,000 toys all over the floor. We can't find the rat. We bring Zach into our room and say, you're going to sleep with us, and we put towels, we did everything, we're going to trap it in there. We get up the next morning, the towel was moved. Not only was it moved, the rat folded it up. There was another door, and he ate through the carpet, through the carpet pad. He made a neat little pile, like a perfect little triangle, just to tease me. He got out. He went to where the door was, and he pulled the towel out. He laid it there, and he went in. I went in to that other room. We had an efficiency that we didn't know what was in there. We had just moved in, and there were about 7,000 rats everywhere. That's how I felt. We finally dealt with the rats, and then one day there was a storm, and I'm coming home. We live right next door to the church, and we're walking next door, and our gutter fell from the storm, and about 20 little baby pink rats. Y'all know what I did? I said, babe, give me the sledgehammer. And I began to splat. Don't act like you wouldn't do it. And I began to splat these rats. I did not want another rat in my house. And vermin would drive you crazy. And I thought, where did these things come from? I had just cleaned them all out. Vermin get anywhere, everywhere, all the time, and you can't control it. And so it says the economic system of this earth is founded on vermin, rats, moths. Moth will get into the dark places of your closet, and they lay eggs, and the larvae come out, and they eat your clothes in order to grow. Doesn't that sound nice? In other words, the economic system of the earth is based on hidden forces operating in dark, cold places that you have no control over. Just in the last few years, we have seen inflation go up. And so now economists say that every household now has the equivalent to $7,000 less a year just because prices went up. I don't even buy Bluebell no more. I do without. No, I'm lying to you. I get Creamy Creations. I a sad state of the world right now. Sad. Now what's happening? Now he talks about people break in and steal. People are going to steal stuff. People are going to break into your house. How many of y'all had somebody break in and steal something in your house? I'm just wondering. Anybody? A few of you? Yeah. Some of you had cars stolen. Right? We had a truck stolen one day right out of the church parking lot during church. We didn't pray for them. No. We went after them, baby. You know. We said, Lord, help us find them. So we can lay hands on them. In the name of Jesus. People still, we had the church van stolen one time. And Amy gets on Facebook, puts a picture of the church van because they look the same. So we had another one. And has anybody seen this? Somebody sent a message that it's parked in our cul-de-sac. Amy doesn't call the police. She gets in the car. I said, where are you going? She said, to get the van back. I said, I'll go with you. So we get over there, and I talk around. I said, let's wait for the police. We need a police report. Let's wait. We don't know what's in there. And so we're waiting on the police. As we're waiting, the people who stole the van walk out of a house, get in the van, and start driving away. I said, the police will take care of it. She said, no, I'm going to follow them. And so we follow them all over the place. We're on the phone with the police. We're following the guy. He comes to a dead-end stop, turns around, and he has to come right back next to us. His window's open. Amy's driving. Her window's open. And this guy is probably 2 feet from her. Could have had a gun. Could have had anything. But my wife doesn't like it if you steal. So people steal. Sometimes they do it legally through laws. They will change stuff. Things happen. None of us can control so much of what happens in the economy. You can't control how much eggs cost. You can't control whether inflation's going to go up or go down. You can't control how much a barrel of oil is. You can't control whether you're going to have your job tomorrow. You could walk in there. And so what he's saying is the economic system of the earth is constantly being consumed by what you have accumulated. It's being stolen. It's being taken. And so because we can't control all that stuff, because there are things happening in the dark, in dark rooms where we don't have any say, even rich people that think they have all kinds of influence, they don't control everything. And so something's going to happen. They could lose all their money in the stock market. We could go into a recession, a depression. I mean, all kinds of stuff. You could wake up one day and your boss has said, I've closed up the business. You don't have a job. I mean, there is no guarantee about anything. That is the earthly economy, and so it works to form my spirit in stress. I'm always worried. Is it going to be okay? Am I going to do good enough? Will I get the promotion? Can I afford the payments? Am I going to make the bills? Am I going to be able to take care of my kids? Can I send them to college? Can I take care of a baby? What if the baby gets sick? I don't have any insurance. I mean, all the different things that are. And so the earthly economy is working constantly in order to create stress and fear and worry and greed. Amen? That's what's happening. And he's talking about this economic system. And so let me get you to go down just a little bit, Matthew 6:25. Because of the economic system of this earth, it has a tendency to make you stress and worry. So here's what Jesus said in verse 25. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry. We could just stop there. That'd be a great sermon. We don't know how to do it, but it sounds good. Do not worry. Do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, or do not eat or drink about your body. What you will wear is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes. Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you? You have little faith. So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, And all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Amen? In other words, you don't have to live like this. The whole system is working to drive you crazy, to stress you out. And then what happens when we get stressed? We snap at one another. And so the economic system of this earth begins to affect our marriages, how we parent, how we talk to our coworkers. And so it is a wickedness that is operating in such a powerful way. And we have to live in it. This is what Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, John 17, verse 15. He says, my prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. And as you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. For them I sanctify myself, that they too may be truly sanctified. Amen? He's saying you don't have to live like that. We can live in this world that is causing everybody in the world to be stressed out, ulcers, high blood pressure, frantic, running from here to there, so busy they can't spend time with one another. And God says you can live in that and still have peace. God don't need your money. God's not sitting there, I hope they don't get sick because I don't know how I'm going to pay their bills. God doesn't need you to wake up. God could just make the grass turn into fruit. He can make the weeds turn into beef. That'd be pretty cool, wouldn't it? Because I got a lot of weeds in my yard. Okay. God doesn't need any of that. So God can do anything. And so let me get back into this. In verse 22, he says, the eye is the lamp of the body. Everybody say eye. If your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? Now, if you have ever been in a place that is totally dark, no light at all, and you see a little bit of light, where do your eyes go? They go to the light. The light draws us. So what he's saying here is wherever you focus, you will be drawn that direction. If you focus and your priority is based in the financial economy of this earth, then you're going to be drawn further into the economy of this earth. And so stress is going to give birth to more stress. And worry gives birth to more worry. And fear gives birth to more fear. And as you continue to stay in it, it just gets worse and worse and worse and worse. Amen? And so what we prioritize determines our direction spiritually. If I prioritize my relationship with Jesus Christ, then I'm not going to be susceptible to the economy of this earth. But if I prioritize my money and how am I going to pay? And this isn't for rich people. This is for anybody. Everybody's got money stress. And so if I think about that too much, if that's on my mind too much, if I'm more worried about work than I am church and more worried about paying bills and reading the Bible and more worried about making money than making disciples, if I'm worried about that, it is going to draw me deeper and deeper into this black hole of this earth's economy. But God says you don't have to live that way. Amen? So let's talk about heaven's economy, heavenly treasures. Now the word treasure here means deposit. Everybody say deposit. When you put a deposit down on something, you're buying a little bit of what you're going to get a whole lot more of later. And so if you put your deposit, if you focus on the earthly economy, then you're going to get more of the earthly economy. Stress begets stress. But the same thing happens the other way around. If I focus on my relationship with God, it will draw me to God. If I focus on Christ, it will draw me deeper into a relationship with Him. What do you think about all day? What fills up your mind? Is it praise to God or is it financial stress? And so the things of heaven, he's saying the things of earth can be ruined, they can be stolen, but the things of heaven cannot. Nobody can steal your peace. Amen? Somebody's saying, but you don't live with my daughter. No. Whatever they do, the Bible says, if your mind is steadfast on the Lord, you will have a perfect peace. Amen? No matter what people drive like, no matter what people smell like, no matter how people act, you will have a perfect peace. And so he's saying here, nobody can take it. You need to focus more on the peace of God than the payment of your bills. You got to focus more on the love of God than what you got left over in layaway. You got to focus on the things of God, because nobody can steal that from you. When we used to go to a church under the bridge, I was really blown away the first time we went. There was a man, he was a very large man, he was about 6'7", 6'8", and there was something wrong with his knees, and so he was on a walker. And he lived in an apartment downtown, even though it was income based and everything. So he was very, very poor. And so he came and I said, How far did you walk? And he said, it's about 5 miles. So he walked downtown in the heat for about 5 miles to get to church under the bridge. And I said, Are you here for the food? And he says, well, I need the food. I don't have much food, but I'm here for the worship. And as the worship band began to play, he began to sing so loud. He sang louder than they were coming through the speakers. And he knew every word to every song. And anybody that went up to him, he gave them a giant bear hug. He would pray for them, and his laughter filled the room. He was a poor man, but he was rich. Nobody could take his joy. Nobody could take his peace. Nobody could take his worship. No matter what the world had done, no matter how he got there, no matter how many people had stomped on him, he was with Christ, and nobody could take that from him. Amen? And so our peace should never be beholden to our finances. We shouldn't be more at peace when we have more money and less at peace when we have less money. Amen? Jesus and Jesus alone can bring us peace. Amen? Now, you may be thinking, preacher, why are you telling me this? Because obviously I'm prioritizing my relationship with Christ. That's why I'm here. And I consent that. That's why we're here. But it's very interesting, and something we can't miss, that when Christ is speaking of this, he's using the same transactional currency terminology in both. And he's teaching us it's not just going to church. It's not just praising him with our lips, but it's how you use your money. Now, it's not because God needs our money. It's because when our money gets our focus off of Christ, then that system that we're talking about steals us away from God. Little by little, it's a slow fade, and we little by little begin to worry. We begin to stress. Then we're okay with taking a job and not going to church, and we're okay with not giving. And when people need money, we kind of hold back. And little by little, it begins to cause us to move from a generosity place to a place of stinginess. And God is saying, you cannot serve me and be wrapped up in this economy. Amen? This is what he says in Deuteronomy chapter 8. And to give you some context before I read this, God is speaking to the Israelites. They've come out of Egypt. They've come out of the desert. They're getting ready to go into the promised land. Now remember, in the desert, they were poor. Every day, God brought down manna from heaven. Amen? And so that's what they ate. They didn't have any steak. They didn't have any lamb. They had crackers every day, saltines, right? And so it was a miracle, yet they didn't have much. But now they're fixing to go into the promised land, and they're going to be rich. And he says, when you get to that place, you better be careful, because that money will mess you up. And here's what he says in Deuteronomy 8, verse 6. He says, observe the commands of the Lord God. Observe the commands of the Lord your God, walking in obedience to him and revering him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land with brooks, streams, and deep springs, gushing out into valleys and hills, a land with wheat and barley, vines and fig trees, pomegranates, olive oil, and honey, a land where bread will not be scarce and you will lack nothing, a land where the rocks are iron and you can dig copper out of the hills and all the bluebell you want. And he says, when you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commands, his laws, and his decrees that I'm giving you this day. Otherwise, when you eat and are satisfied, when you build fine houses and settle down, and when your herds and flocks grow large and your silver and gold increase and all you have is multiplied, then your heart will become proud and you will forget the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. He led you through the vast and dreadful wilderness, that thirsty and waterless land with its venomous snakes and scorpions. He brought you water out of a rock. He gave you manna to eat in the wilderness, something your ancestors had never known, to humble and test you so that in the end it might go well with you. You may say to yourself, my power and the strength of my hands have produced this wealth for me. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth. And so confirms his covenant. Amen. Now the covenant is spiritual. It is my communion with God. And what he's saying is that he has given us money to confirm that. He did not give you money so you could pay for electricity, because he could bring electricity with lightning bolts however he wants to. He didn't give you money so you can buy a house. He can provide a shelter with trees or whatever. He didn't give you money so that you could go out and buy a car. He could just lift you up from one place to another. None of the things that we use money for is why he gave you money. He gave us money to confirm in order to stay in communion with him. Because what happens right after this is they receive the Mosaic Law, and God says, everything that I give to you, I want you to give back to me. In fact, the law was, do not even come to worship unless there was something in your hand to offer back to me. Why? Because he understood all of this wealth would corrupt them. All of this money, all of the riches. And he said, in order to help you stay humble and stay in covenant with me, I'm giving you money so you can give it to me so that you will remember I'm the one who did it. Because if you begin to think that you're your own provider, then you are your own God. And what we do is we say, well, Lord, I know you want me to give, but I can only give, you know, a little bit here and there that I can afford. But if we're only giving what we can afford, are we trusting God to be our provider? You see, when we think about God and the definition of God that we have is that he is our protector and provider. And we're very good about going to God for protection. Lord, I need help. This person's doing that, and that's happening here, and I need some help. And we go to God in protection. But whenever we need provision, we need help, we need a job, we will pray one thing but then do something else. We say, Lord, I trust you. I know you will provide. I know you will, but I don't trust you with my money. I don't trust you to really provide. I know you'll provide a job for me, but I don't trust you to provide, because we don't use our money the way God has called us to use our money. The way we use it will determine who we exalt as our provider. Either he is my provider or he ain't. In the scripture, the number 10 is used a lot. And the number 10 represents completion. And so the Bible says that he had 10 commandments. These 10 commandments represented the complete law. So over 600 laws could be summed up, and these 10 commandments represented that. The Bible says that the Passover lamb was chosen on the 10th day of the month, because the Passover lamb, one thing, represented all who would believe. The Day of Atonement, which was the major sacrifice of the year, happened on the 10th day of the month, because it was a sacrifice for all the people. And so when we begin to understand 10, so now we go back to the Old Testament, and God says, bring the whole tithe. Everybody say tithe. Tithe. Now, the word tithe means 10%. Now, when you study the tithing, they would tithe, and then they would tithe on what was left, and then tithe on what was left after that. And so it was much more than 10%. The New Testament, it says, pray and ask the Lord what you are to give. So I'm not going to sit here and say that I can biblically say without doubt that we are supposed to tithe. But what I can say is that everything in the New Testament is a fulfillment and goes further than the Old Testament. And so when he says tithe, what he's saying, if you'll give me a portion, then I will see that and receive it as if you're giving me everything. And the Bible says, if you give, then it will be given back to you. Pressed down, shaken together, and run it over. Amen? And the question is, do I trust him as my provider? And he's calling us to give to him, to form my spirit. Because if I give to him, I'm constantly remember. Every time, now you can give to God and it be kind of like lip service when you worship. But if you give to him, and as you're clicking the button, writing the check, or dropping the cash in the plate, if you would sit there for just a minute and pause and say, I'm doing this because God has given me the ability to produce well. He has been good to me. And if we will do that, it will form our spirit to the earthly, to the heavenly economy. And we will make a deposit there. And when you make a deposit in the heavenly economy, you keep getting more and more, and you will be drawn closer. The way you use your money will not just separate you from God, but it will set you on a continual path away, or it will set you on a continual path to him, getting closer and closer. And so God is calling us to use our money to honor him. Amen. Today, when you walked in, you got a little card. It's called a giving ladder. We just do this a couple times a year, and I want to give you a chance to fill that out. Now, I don't know how much you give. That's between you and the Lord. I don't look at that. I don't care to see that. And this right here is not where you can say, I'm going to give this amount of money, because that's not the issue. The issue is allowing the Holy Spirit to open your heart to generosity. And so if you have never given, then give. Just make a decision. I'm going to give one time. You may just give a buck. Okay, it doesn't matter. The scripture says, do not despise a small beginning. Amen? You might give 50 cents, whatever it is, but give if you never give. If you've given once, but then not really ever before, then make a decision. I'm going to be a sporadic giver. Every time the Lord prompts me, I'm going to give. And maybe once or twice a year, maybe three or four times, who knows? If you're already that kind of giver, then you may think, well, I'm going to let the Lord take me to the next place, which is proportional, whatever percentage. A certain percentage. Maybe it's a tithe, 10%. Maybe it's 2%. It doesn't matter. But now you're talking about regular sacrificial giving, right? And if you're already there, then pray about how can you be an extravagant giver? How can you give to the Lord and then give above and beyond? And remember, we're not just talking about giving to the church. The Bible says that when somebody is in need, that you give to them. It says you loan money and don't expect repayment. If somebody needs food, give them food. And so this is not just about the church, but it's allowing God to make me a generous person. If you're generous with your money, you will be drawn closer to God. You will have more peace. You'll have more joy. You'll have more love. Amen? So I'm going to give you just a minute to fill that out. And when you leave here today, I'll be out in the foyer. You can bring it to me. If you put your name on it, I'll be praying for you. You don't have to give it to me. It's between you and the Lord. Okay? If you want to keep it, put it somewhere just to remember your commitment. Do that. This is not a fundraising thing. Y'all know I'm not big into that. This is about us being open to God, letting our money be the instrument God wants it to be to draw us near to him. Amen? Amen. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for all that you've done for us. Lord, how beautiful it has been to be in the house of the Lord today. I've been so moved by your spirit, reminded of your grace, challenged by your word, and loved by your body. I love being in the house of the Lord. So we praise you, we give you glory, we give you praise. Heavenly Father, I ask that you would protect every home and the finances of every home represented here today. Or that whatever they may be going through, Lord, that you would open doors and create opportunities and bless them. Lord, for your name's sake, and Lord, we ask that you would help us to honor our commitments. And Lord, when we fail, we are so grateful that we have a God who is forgiving and not condemning. And Lord, help us just not to give up and to keep fighting this economic system of the world and fight to live in the kingdom of God. We give you all the praise and all the glory. Everybody said together, amen. Amen. Let's give the Lord a praise already this morning. Amen.
Amen. We have tons of events going on here at Crossroads, and we want to encourage you to come and join us and fellowship at some of our events. We have a women and men's retreat coming up in the fall. We have a marriage couples brunch coming up. We have tons of youth and young adult events coming up, too, and they're all on the Church Center app. So I do want to encourage you to check out all the events, get registered for some of the events, because we want to see you at some of these events. We want to see you outside of Sunday morning fellowshipping and meeting and gathering with people and that can pray for you and help you grow with your in your spiritual walk. I also really want to talk today about Fall Fest. It's been a while since we've had our annual Fall Fest. It's one of our largest events that we have here at Crossroads. We really haven't had a full-on Fall Fest post-COVID, so we're excited to be having that this year on October 28th. So be sure to mark your calendars. We're looking for people to help. We're looking for people just to invite. Please be in prayer for the event. If you would like to volunteer, we're looking for volunteers for that also. In previous years, we've had over 1,000 people join us on that one evening. So it's just a great way to minister to the people around us, to welcome our community onto our church, and just to be a blessing and to show love to all of our community. So please keep an eye out for some more information on Fall Fest this year. If you are a first-time guest, we are glad that you're here. We want to meet with you. We have Pastor Lance back there and his wife, Anna, who want to meet with you. We have a free gift for you. One of Pastor Lee's books is in that gift as well. So we hope to connect with you back there. And as always, our mission here at Crossroads is to love people into a loving relationship with Jesus Christ. So let that resonate with you. And let's find a way to love people into a loving relationship with Jesus Christ. Let's be intentional about that as we go into this week. Have a great week. You are dismissed.